Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? The show starts in 3, 2, 1, go.
Good morning, Canesport. It's August 20th, 2021. I'm Gary Furman, the publisher of Canesport.com, joined by our managing editor, Matt Shodell, and we're talking about the news of the day. And Matt, I guess the news of the day is more today like the news of last night, because big night out on Greentree Practice Field. We had a chance to watch some more practice, had a chance to do some really good interviews. So a ton of phenomenal content on the site this morning. So let's jump right into it. Let's talk about practice first. And I thought that in the periods that we were able to watch, that it really was the first time this fall that the team started looking a little tired of fall camp to us, I think. We both kind of noticed it. They seem to be dragging a little bit. Not surprising, really. They've been in training camp now for almost 2 weeks. And they're long days. You know, they meet during the day. They do different things. And they practice in the evenings. Then they go home and get ready to do it all again the next day. Now they're getting ready for scrimmage number 2 on Saturday, which really is the huge scrimmage of the fall. Manny Diaz equated it tonight to the third exhibition game in the NFL, which now really is the second exhibition game in the NFL, now that they only play 3 of them. But we get the idea. So the team looked to us tonight a little bit like they could use a little bit of injection of energy. Your thoughts on that?
I mean, yeah, the reporters were mentioning it also. You know, it was like really just not what I picture a Miami Hurricanes practice being like. You know, you want guys running out. You know, they come out from the IPF. Usually you want to see them sprinting out, getting into their wherever their individual drills. They do special things for us. So sprint out to your spot, whatever. They were walking out. They were just quiet. They weren't even talking to each other. Just super weird. You know, a couple of guys were jogging. Other kids were walking. Nobody seemed in a rush to do anything. So, yeah, maybe it's, you know, they talk about, you know, with camp doldrums or whatever. I mean, I'm not going to read too much into it unless it continues. You know, I thought the previous practices have been pretty good energy levels. I mean, you know, not like amazing like back in the day, but certainly better than like the Al Golden years when it was just silence out there. But like today, it was pretty quiet out there. You know, normally over the previous fall, I think there's been much, you know, a decent amount of energy, I'd say. And today it disappeared. So, you know, hopefully the next time we're out there, we'll see a rejuvenated team again, you know.
Well, a 4-week training camp is a long time before you play the game. You know, let's be honest. And they're kind of like in the middle of the span of time between scrimmages, and they got the big scrimmage Saturday. So this was a Thursday night practice. So it's understandable. Wasn't the only thing that was kind of out of whack. You know, towards the end of practice, they're practicing in the indoor practice facility. And the other day we heard them blasting Alabama band music over the loudspeakers in the indoor practice facility. Well, last night we heard the FSU fight song. And I was thinking, did somebody like switch the schedule or something? Like, what, you know, what's going on? Why are they playing the da 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 da? It's like blasting like crazy on the speakers inside the indoor. So that was kind of funny. But anyway, so after practice ended, we had a chance to talk to Manny Diaz for a while, and he updated us on some different things. And a big thing that's been on a lot of minds the last couple of days, because they were missing from workouts, was Zion Nelson and Nesta Severo. We didn't think they're hurt very badly. Where were they? What was going on? And then they weren't out there again today. And then so that was making it like really mysterious. And we started thinking, could they be in COVID protocols or contact tracing or something like that? So we asked Manny about it. And you guys will see that on the site this morning. And Manny's response was they were a little sore. So make that of that what you wish is what we would say. But he indicated that both Zion and Nesta will be back for practice, maybe not for the scrimmage on Saturday, but by the beginning of next week when they shift gears and start Alabama preparations. So I would classify that, Matt, as good news.
Yeah, I mean, look, coaches never want to really talk about why guys are missing practice. You know, I would think if somebody has a surgery, he would just say they had a surgery. But other than that, he's not going to tell you anything. So the fact that he says he'll be back, I mean, I believe him. So, you know, they'll be back next week. I think that's fine. There's plenty of time to get ready. You know, I think, you know, Zion missed probably it'll be about a week and a half. And I think Nesta maybe about a week by the time they get back. So not the end of the world.
All right, and Manny elaborated on a lot of other things in that interview. You guys can check the full interview out on the website this morning. We've got a video of it for you there as well. A couple other stories for today. Excited to see Navon Donaldson. His first opportunity this fall to really talk to Navon. And I like the way that he elaborated a little bit about what his offseason was like and what he's been through. I mean, this kid has persevered through a lot. He had to try to get his weight down, and that was really difficult. He wouldn't tell us what he weighed. You know, not a surprise. It's a delicate subject with Navon. He's a very big human being. But he does look pretty good and looks in decent shape, and we've been watching him in practice. He's moving around relatively well. And a healthy and active Navon Donaldson takes the Miami run game to a whole new level. And so you sense a lot of excitement, Matt, just in general from a lot of people, that Navon is back out there with the first team.
Yeah, and just to clarify, I mean, I think he was talking more about like coming off the injury at the end of 2019. Like that's when he, like, you know, couldn't walk without crutches or with aid for 6 months. And that's sort of when he really got out of shape from the doldrums. I think this offseason he was pretty much fine. He participated in the spring and he's been working hard all summer. But yeah, having him back is a big deal. You know, there's a reason why they moved DJ Scaife to be, you know, potentially a backup at both guard and tackle spots. You know, it's not like DJ's a bad player. He's a really good player. So that just shows you, like, right when Navon got back, they're like, he's a starter. Like, that's how good he is. I think he's going to be outstanding this year. I really do.
And one positive in terms of the O-line is that they've been able to move some guys around. With Zion not there, we saw Jared Williams playing left tackle. We saw DJ Scaife back at right tackle. A lot of mixing and matching going on. Jalen Rivers looks very good at left guard. Looks like he's picking it up and getting better and better every practice. So there's some encouraging things going on there at the offensive line position. All right, another great interview I thought that we were able to get last night was Keyshawn Smith. And this is a kid that we and a lot of other people are just waiting to bust loose. Got an enormous amount of ability. When you talk to the people out in the San Diego area where he came from, they talk in such glowing terms about him. Like when they expected him to come to Miami and be an immediate superstar. It hasn't exactly played out that way. Not so unusual for young players. But you see that this is a kid just really primed to bust out. And you're hoping here in the next couple weeks you put it all together, win that third starting job possibly for the Alabama game, and then get opportunities. And I think if he gets opportunities, Matt, that this is a kid that's going to rise up very fast in the status chart of Miami football.
Yeah, and I mean, in retrospect, it's probably a little bit of a shame that he didn't get more opportunities last year, because, you know, I think that would have helped him grow even more right now, you know, sort of having that experience going against different types of corners and different situations in live games, because now you've got Alabama's game one. It's a little bit of a tough situation for a young kid like that. He said to us today, or yet last night rather, that you know, he said, like, you know, this is a new stage. He hasn't been on a stage like this before, you know, and we'll see how he responds. But yeah, I mean, it's got all the potential in the world. And I would just add the receiver group in general. I mean, when you look at last year's starters, and one of them is a third teamer right now, Mark Pope, and the other one's a second teamer, probably heading to the third team after a couple more drops last night, D. Wiggins, like, these other guys are stepping up, you know, and there's a reason why Mark and D are feeling the pressure and sort of having some mental struggles, because they see, oh my gosh, these other receivers are really, really good. It's a really good receiver group. You know, Mike Redding and the three freshmen in particular, I think Jacoby George will have a role, and maybe even Breshard Smith. You know, so Yed and Keyshawn, and, you know, obviously with Mike and with Charleston, I mean, that's a really good receiver group to me.
Now, we did see some drop balls at practice last night. And I chalked that up to being just part of the overall kind of hitting a little bit of a fall camp wall. The level of concentration might not quite have been there the way it's been, because we haven't seen a lot of guys dropping balls for the most part this fall. Last night, there were an inordinate number of drop balls. And Like I said, I chalk that up to just the general fatigue of fall camp. And hopefully with the scrimmage coming up Saturday, the guys will bounce out of it, have a good scrimmage. It'll be really interesting to see the results coming out of that scrimmage, because I think this is the one where Manny Diaz is going to really dial up the defense. I'm not sure he did that in scrimmage one, and the offense kind of had their way a little bit. I think this will be the scrimmage where they really go after it and see how ready you guys are for what Alabama might bring in a couple weeks. So we'll keep an eye on that. Okay, another interview that we had last night was with Jared Harrison Hunt. And this is a kid who, obviously, we've all seen him flash at times. On individual plays last season, he looked spectacular, Matt, but didn't have the consistency. And I thought it was really interesting when I asked him about that last night, that he kind of admitted that he didn't really, really, really know what he was doing last year, and that he was just getting by on athleticism. Remember, he was a basketball player in high school, and that this year is a whole different deal. He feels so much more prepared. he talked very highly of how Jess Simpson has been working with him and teaching him things, and the impact of that coaching is having on him. And I think Jared is a guy to watch for this year who can also bust out, much in the mold of like a Keyshawn Smith and Xavier Restrepo on the offensive side of the ball.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, he actually started over John Ford last season, and then immediately was sidelined for like three or four games because of COVID issues. So that's real. I mean, you can call it inconsistency if you want, but I thought he was very good until that happened, and then he never really got back. You know, that's just what happens. He barely played after that. You know, the bowl game, he played a little bit, didn't have an impact. Just didn't have an impact after that. But he's another guy. Tons of athleticism and talent, just raw talent. So, it's interesting to me. I really thought by now in fall camp he'd be like the number one guy, but you still see John Ford lining up with the ones all the time on the initial depth chart. So, it's going to be interesting next week when we get back out of practice to see what the new depth chart's going to look like after this next scrimmage.
Yeah, and let's not sleep on Leonard Taylor either, because I'm hearing really good reports on him and how he's doing out there, and he's a guy that I think might be working his way into that rotation as well. So you like the competition. We've seen a lot of John Ford. I will say that he's probably the best model of John Ford right now that he's been in his career at Miami, as he should be. He's an older player. But that would be a spot where, if we're honest, we would say that the Miami Hurricanes need to find a way to be better than what they've been the past several seasons at that spot. And I think Jared Harrison Hunt gives them a chance to go to that next level there. And if he's able to overtake John Ford as a starter, I would look at that as a positive as opposed to a negative, even though obviously John wouldn't be very happy about it. But it would mean that Miami's making progress at the defensive line position. All right, we also have the continuation of our 15 impactful players in 15 days series today with number 7, Will Mallory. And Matt, this is a guy that, even though Arroyo as the freshman backup is doing a good job in fall camp, I would say Will Mallory is one of the guys that Miami can least afford to lose this year. They really need him to stay healthy. And if he does, he should have a great year.
Yeah, I mean, he's not going to be Brevin Jordan, but, he's a tall, rangy receiver, receiving tight end, good enough as a run blocker. So the problem there is you can't afford to lose him because you got nothing behind him. You got a lanky freshman, Elijah Arroyo, who needs to put on a lot of weight. So, and then after that, you have Larry Hodges, who's had some personal issues, and Dom Memorelli's been hurt. So, yeah, he's got to stay healthy.
All right, so that'll give you guys a lot to sink your teeth into this morning. And obviously, as the day goes on and into the weekend, we'll have additional content for you guys to enjoy. But we got the scrimmage on Saturday night this week, and not Sunday night. It's Saturday night this week. So we'll be mining for details on that through the weekend. We'll have reports for you on Saturday night. And all in all, the countdown to Alabama is here. You're down to 15 days now before Miami will be in Atlanta taking on the Crimson Tide, and that's obviously quite a bit to look forward to. So for Matt Schodel, I'm Gary Furman. Thank you for joining us this morning, and we'll see you next time, everybody.